So my group really works in the area of what's called biomedical optics. So we use optical methods, in particular light sources. It could be lasers, could be LEDs, certain colors, could be red, blue, could be in the near-infrared. And we probe tissue, human tissue. So one of the big projects that we have been pursuing is really looking at breast cancer. Standard is mammography, really. So you compress the breast, which is actually very uncomfortable for a woman. And then you look for what's called calcifications, because these tumors start often in these milk ducts, and there are calcifications that can be picked up with x-rays. And if there's a lesion, then you actually go into a biopsy and see if it's serious or not. And often it's actually not. Beyond just being that it's uncomfortable, the recommendation have shifted. Well, so at some point it was say, well, only older than 50, then younger than 40, or not younger than 45. So these seem to shift depending on how far along people are in the studies you look at. But they definitely don't work for younger women under 40, because at that point the breast tissue is just it's too dense and the x-ray won't pick it up as well. And so it's not recommended for young women. Now, using light has the advantage, though, that limitation is actually not there. You don't use x-rays. X-rays itself, if you take too many x-rays, so for example, you wouldn't do x-rays every 2 weeks, because then the radiation exposure is so high that you may actually induce the cancer. That you don't have it with light. You could pretty much every week or even continuously monitor this or every day and repeat it, and there is no effect on the tissue in terms of does it damage it or produces cancer. We have actually built a system where we shine light, both breasts at the same time. They are in some cups where there's optical fibers getting to these different locations on the breast, and then we shine light in there, typically more near-infrareds, into the tissue, and then we measure how much is transmitted, back reflected. So we look at different locations, how much light comes out. And then we take that information and come up with maps of basically oxy, deoxy, and total hemoglobin. So we look at basically where there's blood in the breast. It's actually known that many tumors, including breast tumors, they recruit new blood vessels, or they, once they grow, they generate their own vascular network because they need the oxygen, they need nutrition to grow. So wherever there's a tumor, you will actually see an increase in total blood volume, and you will see more oxygenated blood. So these things change. And right. Since our methods is sensitive to that, we can see where in the breast is there more blood. We started out looking at just detection of breast tumors or finding them. But what became more apparent, or where our clinical collaborators guided us, they were interested in looking at monitoring treatment. So in treatment of breast cancer over the last 5 to 10 years, there has been a shift where kind of before, what was done is basically whatever was seen, or if there was a mass, it was kind of biopsies, was taken out the surgery, and then you would do chemotherapy to kill whatever is left over. Now it's much more common to do what's called neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So you give chemotherapy for 6 months, try to shrink the tumor, or maybe the tumor even disappears, and then cut out whatever is left over, or maybe there's no surgery because the tumor disappeared. And what this is, you actually save breast tissue, are not as invasive, and you can show that the 5-10 year survival rates are higher if you do it this way around than the other way around. The challenge is that it's maybe only half or 60% of the women actually respond to the chemotherapy. So the other half go through 6-7 months of a regimen, which is lots of side effects. I mean, hair falls out, nausea, and all kinds. Well, chemotherapy is very invasive in that way. And they have no benefit. After 6 months, the tumor is still there, and then they still have to do the surgery. So the goal was then, can we identify or monitor the process and predict which patient will respond and which patient will not respond? Again, we're looking at that tumor. We see there's a lot of blood there. We can look at the dynamics in the tumor. So we actually ask the patient to hold their breath, however long they can do it, maybe 20, 30 seconds. So we can actually now monitor like the blood inflow and outflow out of this tumor and use that as a diagnostic tool. So the study that we initially figured out, we would do imaging just before the treatment starts, then at 2 weeks, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and then just before the surgery, or the final assessment. So, but what we found, if we see an effect after 2 weeks, meaning there's actually a noticeable decrease of blood in that area, it's very likely that the patient will respond to the therapy. If basically nothing changes in the first 2 weeks, or very little, the amount of blood in that area stays the same, the dynamics stay the same, turns out that there's a very high likelihood that the patient will not respond to the therapy. Really, to bring it to the point, either it works right away or it won't work even if you keep treating and you keep giving the drug for 6 months, the effects are not as great.